Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Savneet Kaur from Gautam Budh University. Today we are going to discuss about the module Nuclear Reprogramming and its applications in molecular therapeutics under the paper Molecular Therapeutics. So in this course, we will talk about the basics about nuclear reprogramming, the techniques which are used for nuclear reprogramming, which includes somatic cell nuclear transfer, nuclear reprogramming by cell fusion, then transcription factor mediated reprogramming, or what we call as induced pluripotent stem cells. We'll talk about therapeutic applications of these techniques, and we'll also discuss about the mechanisms. So the differentiation of a somatic cell or of a pluripotent cell into an adult differentiated cell, it is considered to be highly stable. Adult differentiated somatic cells, they very rarely change from one differentiation state to another. For example, a brain cell cannot become a liver cell, or a liver cell cannot become a heart cell. But now, using a set of experimental techniques, it is possible to change the differentiation state of a somatic cell to another cell type by a process what we call as nuclear reprogramming. Now, nuclear reprogramming can be dedifferentiation, where it involves the change of a differentiated cell into a pluripotent cell, or it can also be called as transdifferentiation, where we switch from one differentiated cell to another differentiated cell. Coming to the historical background of reprogramming, nuclear reprogramming is not a new concept. It was more than 50 years ago when Braggs and Kings, they provided the first evidence to show that the differentiated cells can reprogram into a more pluripotent state. They demonstrated that the injection of frog blastula cell nuclei into the cytoplasm of frog oocytes that could give rise to normal nucleated swimming frog tadpoles. Now, after the initial experiments by Braggs and Kings, it was in 1960s when a group led by Gurdon documented that even more differentiated somatic cell nuclei, not only the blastula cell nuclei, but even nuclei from more differentiated cells, like those from frog intestine, they could be reprogrammed back, they could be transformed back into an early embryonic state by factors which are present in the egg cytoplasm. So, if we look at the chronology of events in nuclear reprogramming research, the first experiments which were carried out in frog oocytes took place in 1950s. After that, the experiments of Gurdon, they were in 1960s, and more advancement in the field of nuclear reprogramming came after the isolation of mouse and human embryonic stem cells from blastocyst stage in 1980s and 1998. And this led to the cloning of the first sheep, which was called as Dolly, by somatic cell nuclear transfer in 1997. And thereafter, the advancements have led to the generation of patient-specific induced pluripotent stem cells, which are the most advanced version of nuclear reprogramming. So there are three major techniques which are followed for nuclear reprogramming. The first one is somatic cell nuclear transfer, which was the earlier one. The second one is nuclear reprogramming by cell fusion, where we use fuse two kinds of cells for reprogramming. And the third one is nuclear reprogramming by using transcription factors, and the resulting cells, they are termed as induced pluripotent stem cells. Now, somatic cell nuclear transfer, or popularly called as SCNT, it is a process in which the nucleus of a differentiated somatic cell is transferred into the cytoplasm of an enucleated egg. So we take an egg where the nucleus has already been removed, and we transfer the nucleus of a somatic cell into the enucleated egg. Now, this somatic cell nuclear transfer can have two forms. One is called as reproductive cloning, and the other one is called as therapeutic cloning. In reproductive cloning, we make a complete cloned organism from the embryo. That means we go for in vivo development of the embryo. Whereas in therapeutic cloning, we go for an in vitro production of embryonic stem cells from the cloned embryo. So, coming to reproductive cloning, which is the production of the whole organism by somatic cell nuclear transfer. As a technique, we start by taking donor cell, somatic cell, and DNA from the donor cell is put into an enucleated egg cell. The egg cell is also taken from the same animal, female species. Now, the donor somatic cell nuclei as well as the enucleated egg, they both are fused by some electric shock. And it has been reported that factors in the egg, they somehow reprogram the somatic cell nucleus. The nucleus is activated, it starts division to form an embryo. And finally, the embryo is then transferred into a surrogate mother for in vivo development of the embryo. So by surrogate mother, we mean a female which has been already activated by some hormonal activation. And by this technique, various animals like sheep, pigs, goats, cattle, Indian bison, they have been cloned. And as I told you before, that the first sheep, Dolly, which was cloned by using mammary gland cells from an adult sheep, by transferring the mammary gland cell nuclei from an adult sheep to an enucleated sheep egg, was produced by Wilmot and his team in 1997. And this sheep, it survived for almost 6.5 years. I would like to tell you that here the normal lifespan of a sheep is 12 years. So there were some abnormalities which developed in Dolly, and so she could live only for 6.5 years. But it was definitely the first successful attempt of producing full cloned animal by nuclear reprogramming. So basically, the major applications of reproductive cloning, they include generation of multiple copies of genetically superior farm animals. We can produce animals with genetically superior characteristics, especially which are beneficial for the meat industry and for the dairy industry. Then by producing multiple copies, we can also go for preservation of endangered species by using reproductive cloning. However, there are major challenges involved in the technique, like we have low cloning efficiency and high incidence of developmental abnormalities. Currently, it is known that efficiency of somatic cell nuclear transfer ranges between 0 to 10%. That means we have only 0 to 10 live births when we transfer about 100 cloned embryos. Besides this, there can be other limitations too, like low quality of oocytes, lack of synchronization between donor cell and the oocyte, improper embryo reconstruction in vitro, and definitely an improper or an abnormal in vivo development of the embryo. So all these make reproductive cloning a little more tedious technique. Another part of somatic cell nuclear transfer is therapeutic cloning. In therapeutic cloning, the process of somatic cell nuclear transfer remains the same. That means we have an enucleated egg cell and a somatic cell nuclei. The nuclei from the differentiated cell is fused with the egg cell, which is activated. It gets divided, and at the blastocyst stage, instead of putting this embryo in the surrogate mother or going for in vivo development, we harvest the cells of the blastocyst, the inner cell mast cells, and culture them outside as pluripotent embryonic stem cells. So therapeutic cloning is performed not to produce another organism, but to harvest embryonic stem cells for use in medical treatments after the nuclear transfer. The process of therapeutic cloning is very similar to that of nuclear reprogramming, reproductive cloning, or somatic cell nuclear transfer. But instead of implanting the cloned embryo in the host, the stem cells are removed and the embryo is killed. The stem cells are then differentiated into different cell types, which can then be used for cell replacement therapy for treatment. So the therapeutic cloning has a lot of potential. It has shown potential to create various types of tissues, various types of cells, such as osteoblasts to treat osteoporosis, spinal cord cells to for regenerating spinal cord, usually after trauma, or even to differentiate cells into neurons to treat neurological diseases or Parkinson diseases. But all these have been achieved only in the animal models, because human therapeutic cloning has its own disadvantages or own pitfalls. Well, it's a promising tool in human tissue engineering, in de novo organogenesis, which will definitely solve the problems of immune rejection and organ shortage for transplantation in humans. If we combine gene therapy and therapeutic cloning, it has an excellent potential for correction of genetic disorders, such as severe combined immunodeficiency syndrome. So, human therapeutic cloning definitely has a large potential, but there are many ethical issues which are involved with the cloning of human cells. It was reported in the year 2004 and 2005 by a South Korean researcher that they have successfully harvested pluripotent embryonic stem cells from a cloned human blastocyst using the technique of therapeutic cloning. However, it was in 2006 that the journal Science, in which the study was published, retracted both of his articles, as there was evidence that the data from the experiments was fabricated. Finally, it was in 2013 where a group of scientists led by Mitalipov et al. It generated 4 embryonic stem cell lines from fetal somatic cells, which were obtained from cloned blastocysts. But as I said, that the major roadblock in the feasibility of human therapeutic cloning is the availability of good quality human oocytes for research, and definitely ethical concerns which are involved in donation of these oocytes, as well as which are also involved in the killing of cloned embryos, because we have to get embryonic stem cells only after killing of the embryos in therapeutic cloning. The next technique by which reprogramming is possible is called as cell fusion. Now, transcriptional changes in somatic cells can be achieved when we fuse the plasma membranes of different cell types. So, upon fusion, the nuclei of both these cells can remain separate in a common cytoplasm, which we call as heterokaryon formation, or they can fuse to form a hybrid genome after mitosis, and this is called as the synkaryon. So, for reprogramming a differentiated cell into embryonic stem cell, we can take one cell as somatic cell and fuse it with another pluripotent embryonic stem cells. And as you can see, the fusion can result in either in the formation of heterokaryon, or it can result in the formation of a synkaryon. So, in case of heterokaryons, there is no cell division, and synkaryons, we have a fusion of both the genomes, because the synkaryons undergo DNA replication and cell division during the fusion process. Another technique of creating reprogrammed cells is by the use of transcription factors. Now, pluripotency is induced in adult cells, in adult human cells, by using 4 factors: OCT 3 or 4, SOX 2, KLF 4, and c-myc, and this was first shown by Yamanaka et al. In 2006. The human induced pluripotent stem cells, as they were called, they were analyzed and they were found to be very similar to human embryonic stem cells in terms of morphology, in terms of proliferation, in terms of their surface marker phenotype, in terms of their epigenetic profile, and also the telomerase activity, which is associated with cell senescence. So, not only these cells were morphologically similar to embryonic stem cells, but they were also similar functionally as the induced pluripotent stem cells. They differentiated into the cells of the 3 germ layers in vitro, which we call as embryoid body formation, and also they differentiated into cells of the 3 germ layer in vivo, what we call as teratoma formation. So, the induced pluripotent stem cells produced by the use of these 4 factors, they were similar to embryonic stem cells, both in terms of morphology and function. Now, coming to the derivation of induced pluripotent stem cells, since the earlier report by Yamanaka et al. In 2006 regarding induced pluripotent stem cells, there have been many advancements in the derivation of these cells. The first step definitely is the establishment of the somatic cell culture, which we have to program. The second step is to treat these somatic cells with Yamanaka's cocktail, which includes the four pluripotency factors which we discussed. Nowadays, people have also started using two or three factors to get induced pluripotent cells. And finally, there are also many advancements in the methods of delivery of these transcription factors. Like we can use both integrating viral systems as well as integration-free systems. Integrating viral systems include the retroviral system, the lentiviral system, whereas the integration-free virus systems, there are certain viruses like DNA viruses, for example, adenoviruses, which do not integrate into the host genome but can lead to the expression of the transfected gene. We can use plasmid DNA. Instead of genes, we can also transfer synthetic mRNA and recombinant proteins in the differentiated or somatic cells for creation of iPSCs. And final step, after the delivery of these transcription factors or pluripotency factors, we can characterize iPSCs and expand them into colonies. The potential applications of induced pluripotent stem cells are quite immense. We can use them in regenerative medicine, we can use them in disease modeling studies, we can use them in cytotoxicity studies and drug discovery. Since the potential of iPSCs is similar to the potential of embryonic stem cells, we can transform them into any kind of adult stem cells like fibroblasts, skin cells like keratinocytes or astrocytes, neurons or hepatocytes, and then we can transplant them back. The major advantage of iPSCs is that we can get them from the same patient which is suffering from the disease and transplant them back into the same patient. So they qualify for the autologous regenerative therapy. Further, if we combine induced pluripotent stem cells with gene therapy, the genetic disorders which are caused by mutations in genes, they can be corrected, and these repaired induced pluripotent stem cells can then further be transplanted back in the same patient or in the autologous manner. And finally, if we isolate or derive these stem cells from patients and do not repair the defect, these unrepaired induced pluripotent stem cells, they can be used in disease modeling, study the mechanism or pathogenesis of diseases, and they can also be used for drug toxic analysis. Now, patient-specific iPSCs, as I told you, they are generated from the patients which are suffering from some specific diseases. These have been derived from various diseases like those suffering from adenosine deaminase deficiency related severe combined immunodeficiency syndrome. This adenosine deaminase is an enzyme which is very much related to the immune system development in humans, and the deficiency of this enzyme, this causes high deficiency of T and B cells, so we call the disease as severe combined immunodeficiency syndrome. And Gaucher's disease, which is a lysosomal storage disease, again this is a genetic disease. So from both these patients, induced pluripotent stem cells have been derived and they have been used for studying diseases and for drug discovery. Neurodegenerative diseases like Parkinson's disease, they have also been studied using induced pluripotent stem cell as disease models. Then patient-specific iPSCs have also been generated from patients who have been suffering with the genetic disease called as retinitis pigmentosa. This is a genetic disease of the eye where the retina degeneration causes impaired vision. So generated iPSCs, they have been genetically corrected for the particular mutation and then transplanted back into the patients where they have shown, where these cells, transplanted cells, have shown differentiation into the rod photoreceptor cells of the eye. Other conditions that have the potential to be treated by patient-specific induced pluripotent stem cells are hematopoietic disorders, musculoskeletal injury, spinal cord injury, or liver damage by autologous therapy. Now, the major advantage of using induced pluripotent stem cell is that there are no ethical issues which are associated with embryonic stem cells or with therapeutic cloning. The concerns around the use of embryonic stem cells and therapeutic cloning are like informed consent, improper incentives to the oocyte donors, the inhibitions of the women who are donating eggs for the generation of embryo, or even the controversy which is involved in the killing of the embryos, the destruction of the embryos for generation of embryonic stem cells from therapeutic cloning, or for the generation of primary embryonic stem cell lines from the embryos. These controversial issues, they are all not present when we talk of induced pluripotent stem cell technology. So definitely it is much advantageous to use these induced pluripotent stem cells in comparison to embryonic stem cells. The advantages of iPSC technology is that it can be generated from your own cell, from the somatic cells of one's own body, and transplanted back in the autologous manner. So there is no risk of immunorejection as we face in adult stem cells or in embryonic stem cells. Further, the use of these iPSCs as drug testing models, the use of the patient-specific iPSCs as drug cytotoxicity testing models, that may cut the cost associated with animal models and clinical trials, plus the results will be more accurate as compared to the animal models. Now, as the iPSCs, they are derived from individual patients, they also offer an opportunity for modeling diseases on a patient-to-patient basis, which enables the screening of genomic differences between individuals. So that means we can do genomic scans and genomic level differences can be spotted out, which help in the progression of disease, and the screening of pharmacological agents or drugs also will be based on these genomic scans, and so we'll be able to find out ideal therapy for each individual, or what you call as personalized therapy. Reprogramming of the somatic cells from any genetic background to induced pluripotent stem cells has also allowed the generation of cell lines which possess specific disease causing mutations. So these genetic diseases can be studied further and can be treated. Now, in spite of the immense potential, there are certain pitfalls of using induced pluripotent stem cells. Like the generation of induced pluripotent stem cells, it makes the use of retroviral or lentiviral system which integrate into the host genome. So it is highly probable that the viral systems which get incorporated in the host genome, they also activate certain genes like the tumor suppressor genes, and they may randomly integrate into the host genome, which can cause genetic aberration and lead to tumors or teratoma formation. Now, some of the pluripotency factors like c-myc, they have been associated with malignancy and they have proven to be oncogenic in some studies. So most of the groups have now started omitting these factors, and they have used only the three major Yamanaka factors for inducing pluripotency. But these studies have seen less of efficiency by omitting the transcription factor c-myc. Again, it is possible to use induced pluripotent stem cells for modeling of simple genetic diseases with a simple phenotype or with simple genetic traits. But in case of complex diseases like diabetes and obesity, which are governed by complex genetic factors, or along with genetic factors, you have environmental factors influencing these diseases, the modeling and the study, mechanism study, by iPSCs, it becomes difficult. Now, coming to the mechanisms of nuclear reprogramming, besides the technical advancements, various groups are also looking into the underlying mechanisms of nuclear reprogramming. Reprogramming by somatic cell nuclear transfer is usually mediated by the natural components which are present in the oocytes. Now, the oocytes, they contain key maternally inherited transcriptional and epigenetic factors, which are essential for natural reprogramming of the highly specialized genomes of differentiated cells into totipotent cells or pluripotent cells. What are these factors? Still, largely they are undefined. In induced pluripotent stem cells, there is a reprogramming of somatic cells to the embryonic stem cell-like state. So, whatever studies have been done, it's very clear that epigenetic mechanisms are involved, because reprogramming involves the elimination of epigenetic marks, which are inherent of differentiated cells, and the establishment of new epigenetic marks, which are characteristic of pluripotent stem cells. Now, there are techniques which have proven that there is a similarity of gene expression or DNA modification, DNA methylation, microRNA expression between iPSCs and embryonic stem cells, which means that these both of these cells, they are similar in pluripotency because of the presence of epigenetic marks. So the significance of these epigenetic mechanisms in nuclear reprogramming is also further supported by the fact that if you treat somatic cells with compounds that affect chromatin modifications like DNA and histone methylation inhibitors, you can significantly enhance the efficiency of reprogramming in iPS cells. As we have already studied that in embryonic stem cells, the chromatin is usually in active state. So anything which induces the chromatin towards that active state definitely improves reprogramming of the differentiated cell to an active pluripotent cell. Now, to summarize the whole talk, nuclear reprogramming refers to the change of a differentiated somatic cell to another cell type by using a set of experimental techniques. The major techniques what we learned today, they are somatic cell nuclear transfer, cell fusion, and transcription factor induced reprogramming. Somatic cell nuclear transfer is a technique in which the nucleus of a somatic cell is transferred into the cytoplasm of an enucleated egg. Somatic cell nuclear transfer can have two forms, reproductive cloning and therapeutic cloning. Reproductive cloning leads to the formation of a complete new organism via in vivo development of the embryo, whereas therapeutic cloning, it refers to the in vitro culturing of the embryo for generation of embryonic stem cells. Now, somatic cell nuclear transfer, it has been used for the cloning of various animals, sheep, goat, cattle, whereas therapeutic cloning, this holds the potential in replacement cell therapy, although human therapeutic cloning has its own limitations. Induced pluripotent stem cells are generated by transcription factor induced reprogramming, and the transcription factors we use are OCT4, SOX2 and KLF4 and c-MYC. The induced pluripotent stem cells, they have immense therapeutic applications in the generation of patient specific cells. They have no ethical issues, no chances of immunorejection. They can be used for clinical models, for studying of disease mechanisms, and also for drug development and cytotoxicity studies. So nuclear reprogramming, in terms of mechanism, it mainly involves certain epigenetic modifications in the genome of differentiated cells. Thank you.